Welcome to Ladies of Another View on Beck. We have another jam-packed day filled. It's been so exciting. We have so many guests coming from the Capitol to kind of give us a feeling for what's going on up there. It's during the legislative session, it's very important, and it's important for everyone to speak up and speak out. But before we get to that, today is the inauguration day, or I guess what I'd rather talk about is President Trump's farewell speech. He had a really great speech yesterday to stay positive. And then we caught another one this morning. He had the farewell speech this morning. But I want to show you, excuse me, the last couple minutes of his farewell speech.
I can only say this. We have worked hard. We've left it all, as the athletes would say, we've left it all in the field. We don't have to come and say, we'll never say in a month when we're sitting in Florida, we're not going to be looking at each other and saying, you know, if we only worked a little bit harder, you can't work harder. I will always fight for you. I will be watching, I will be listening, and I will tell you that the future of this country has never been better. I wish the new administration great luck and great success. I think they'll have great success. They have the foundation to do something really spectacular. And again, we put it in a position like it's never been before, despite the worst plague to hit since, I guess you'd say, 1917, over 100 years ago. And despite that, the things that we've done have been just incredible. And I couldn't have done it without you. So just a goodbye. We love you. We will be back in some form. So have a good life. We will see you soon. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Wow. Yes, absolutely. You know, to me, it's inspiring, actually, because his story is not over yet. Our country's story is not over yet. I think we have a lot to look forward to. I really do. Yeah. And did anyone else notice there were 17 flags?
Yes. People noticed it.
Did anyone else notice that Melania looked a lot like Jackie Kennedy today in the clothing that she wore? So I'm just going to throw that out there for people to simmer on. And just don't give up hope. You know, our country's gone through turmoil before. Yeah. Ups and downs, and we always will. We always will. And I just think that we have more to look forward to.
Yeah. And I think that when you talk about the turmoil, I mean, we have survived many things. And I really liked what he had to say about how he has put a structure in place where we can remain strong now. I mean, there's a lot of good things in place. I don't know if I want to go there, but I'm going to go there. I've already heard Keystone Pipeline is next. It's done. That first day in, that's what he's doing. He's already, Joe Biden is telling us things he's going to get rid of and things he's going to bring back, like basically the Green New Deal, the Paris Accord. Look at our tax structure and what will that mean? How will our energy bills look? There's a lot going to happen that we need to start to prepare for and figure out what we're going to do.
Yeah, we had a lot of accomplishments. Did you want to touch on that?
Or? There were tons of them. You know, I like how President Trump said, we did hear what we came to do and so much more. Yeah. But when I was looking through the interwebs, and the like to find information on all of these accomplishments. I found lots of sites that listed them, but there were some that actually said they needed to fact check them. So that kind of blew me away. There was a gal named Farrah Stockman of the New York Times. She did kind of a hit piece last October, it was already, on the accomplishments that had been touted thus far, and she said some of the items are false, some are misleading, and some are absolutely true. And that was her fact-checking.
And so, Jan, I just wanted, for our viewers, I just wanted to let you know that there was, his accomplishments were listed on the .gov website, and there were probably 500, 600, 700 of them. It's all been deleted now, so you can't find the page anymore, and I guess that always happens whenever there's a new president. So I just wish we could still share that, but go ahead. I guess
that's fine, and that's important because it's part of this cancel culture that we've been talking about. And, you know, she said that Trump can't take credit for signing any new bills into law because that was really what Congress did. Last I checked, the president was the one that signs a bill into law,
yeah,
but,
exactly.
You know, she kind of didn't think
exactly.
So. He also claims to have finalized the creation of the Space Force as our sixth military branch. And she said, no, well, it's sort of true, but he did have some military leaders that opposed it. So that was her fact-checking there. And then Business Insider, this John Haltiwanger.
Haltiwanger.
He did an analysis, and his analysis was stating in part that through his accomplishments, though they are not popular with his critics, Trump, for better or worse, has been a consequential president. Like, what does that
even mean?
And how does that fact checking? I really don't get it.
Right, right.
And there was one more that I found kind of solidified things for me. Kevin Jackson of the Black Sphere on the Kevin Jackson Network. And I don't know if the guys have a list of it there for you, but he dared the leftists to compare Trump's accomplishments against those of Barack Obama's. You can see here on the screen, Valerie Jarrett cited three things during Obama's 8 years. Obamacare, getting lighter sentencing for crack cocaine, because we all know that, you know, everybody shouldn't be able to have that, ha-ha. But they also had Trump's list of what he did in 4 years. Black unemployment increased by 1.3 million June through October of last year. Hey, during a pandemic, folks. He created the White House Opportunity and Revitalization Council and provided extra federal support to distressed communities, signed legislation creating opportunity zones where approximately 1 million Americans benefited from poverty. There's just a whole bunch, like 45 more of them. But he's the racist? I don't know. I just think don't point your finger because there's three pointing back at you.
Or four. Yeah. Four.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that he did that will last is that on one of his last presidential acts, he declared January 22nd as the National Sanctity of Human Life Day.
Yeah.
I really love what he did during for the economy while he was in office. And unfortunately, Biden is going to rescind the Mexico City policy that does not allow the United States to pay for abortions overseas. So we may lose that, but he did a lot of for the pro-life movement.
And we all know that there are people lining up at the border trying to get in because they've already promised that that he's not going to deport them. So those are things that we're going to talk about some more in the coming days, but we're going to take a break right now and watch these messages on Ladies of Another View on Beck.
Capital City Restaurant Supply is your one-stop shop for quality restaurant products for the large to small kitchens. Commercial-grade restaurant and bar supplies, limb game processing equipment, refrigeration, dinnerware, and smallware. We sell everything including the kitchen sink from trusted manufacturers for the chef and all of us. Open to the public since 1971, we are veteran-owned and North Dakota proud. Let us take care of your restaurant and home kitchen needs today by visiting us at 1414 Interstate Loop in Bismarck or on the web at capitalcityrestaurantsupply.com.
Hi, I'm Dennis Haugen, along with my sons Andy and Mike, and we're showing our support for wind energy in North Dakota.
Wind energy has provided farmers like us with a steady stream of income that's not tied to the weather, like crops and cattle are.
Another bonus is that wind farm owners are required to maintain the roads leading up to the turbines. Because of that, oftentimes these roads are the best in the county.
Wind energy is good for landowners, it's good for the land, it's good for our economy, and it's good for North Dakota.
Are you a thrill seeker, sightseer, or day tripper? The Ford Bronco Sport SUV is built for you. Four Bears Casino is giving away a 2021 Ford Bronco Sport loaded with a ton of interior space, safari-style roof, smooth suspension for any terrain, and easy-to-clean surfaces. Qualify now just by playing your favorite slots at Four Bears Casino. Double points on Sundays. Also get in on Super Senior Wednesdays, slot turning Thursdays, and hot seats on Wednesdays and Thursdays. Spin into Four Bears Casino and Lodge for chances to win.
Some things in life are hard. That's why banking shouldn't be. Cornerstone Bank.
Heroes and Icons is now Cozy TV. Don't worry, you'll still get your favorite Beck News programming without changing the channel. Real people, real news, Beck News.
Welcome back to Ladies of Another View. With us today, we have Luke Simons, a representative out of the Dickinson area, and he is also a rancher and a constitutionalist and all kinds of good things. First of all, welcome to the show. We're so glad that you were able to make it.
Oh, thank you for having me. It's my honor.
Perfect. Awesome. Anyway, so let's just get right to it because we always run out of time. Why don't you talk to us or tell our viewers about some of the bills that you're working on? And the first one is about the Fourth Amendment. Tell us a little bit about that.
The Fourth Amendment? Well, I think most of us know what the Fourth Amendment is. It's a very important part of our history as Americans because of the horrible things that were happening to us during the time of our involvement with Great Britain. Saying that, your Fourth Amendment is pretty, I carry this every single day. I gave all the pages a constitution, and any day that they don't have it in their pocket, they owe me $1. Any day that I don't have it, I owe them $5.
So I hope that you're getting rich on this, or I mean, I hope you're not getting rich, but I hope you're on the winning side of it.
Right.
Well, no, they know I'll request $1, so, and they've never got $5.
There you go.
I've carried this one since 2016, my first year into office. So the Fourth Amendment, for those that maybe aren't familiar, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, effects, against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrants shall issue but upon probable cause, which we all agree with, supported by oath or affidavit, I can't speak today, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the person or things to be seized. Now that's pretty clear.
It seems pretty clear to me.
It is.
So where do we have a problem?
So where we have a problem with, and by the way, our state constitution is even clearer, and you can find that in section 8 of your constitution. So where we have a problem with that is this is my person. If I get on the street and a law officer wants to search me, they need a search warrant for that. That's what they need. And as they should. My vehicle, that's under my effects. My home, that's pretty clear. And your papers, this building would be your papers. This is your place of business. This is your papers. The problem is in agriculture, there's a something called from English law, not common law, and by the way, if you're not a constitutionalist, we practice, or we're supposed to practice, common law in America. Our Constitution was wrote in common law. English law is a doctrine that I do not accept for a lot of things in English law. Saying that, Open Fields Doctrine comes from England, and that is anything in a field or in a prairie or anything like that is not subject to the Fourth Amendment protection.
So when you say in the open, are you talking, you know, just someone's land, or are you talking about if I have barns or outbuildings, you know, because a lot of farmers nowadays, they have more than one farmstead just because
Correct.
Everything's getting getting bigger, I should say.
Absolutely.
So what happens if, like on my property, in my farmyard, what can they do or where can they go?
Well, absolutely. So there's something called curtilage, and no one's familiar with curtilage.
No.
In fact, this happened to me, a constituent.
Well, my milk does it every now and then.
That's the beauty about milk. It never goes bad.
Right.
In a different stage. But so the way I found out about curtilage is one of my constituents had an animal neglect case against him. And they actually made a Hollywood movie, newsflash too. If you haven't heard of Protect the Harvest, it is absolutely awesome.
Yep, I certainly have.
They are awesome. For anybody in ag, they're awesome. But so it was a Democrat, and it was kind of a little bit of a sting. He came in and said, Luke, can I make you look like an idiot on the witness stand? I said, hey, if it's going to help absolutely, yeah, I don't care. And he put me on the platform, and he said, Luke, are you familiar with the Fourth Amendment? Of course, he knew I was. He said, would it shock you if you found out that your chicken coop, if it's 60 feet from your curtilage, from your home, is not protected under the Fourth Amendment? And I said, yes. He said, what would you do if somebody was in your chicken coop? I said, well, I would detain them until the authorities came. He said, what if that was the authorities? I said, well, they'd have to have a search warrant. He said, no, you don't. And that's when I learned about what
wow.
this is. And so, and that's not just seclusive to ranching or farming, boats. So you have a lake cabin, your shop that has your boat in it, they don't need a search warrant to product a, what I call a lawless search and seizure. So your vehicle inside that shop would be covered, but they could walk the whole premise and the inside of the shop,
wow.
but your vehicle would be covered under effects.
Wow.
It's ridiculous.
Okay, so you're saying every building that's 60 feet or further from your home.
Okay.
Is not covered. That could even be in town, too. Like,
right.
a lot of people have a shop if they have a bigger lot
right.
here in town.
Right.
That's correct.
Yes.
So one of our viewers wrote to us after they found out you were going to be on, and he asked about ice houses or fishing houses. He said that as long as they're out ice fishing, that or if it's occupied, anyone can come in there at any time. This is what he had sent us. When in use, fish houses must be open for inspection at all times. I guess that would fall in the true category?
It definitely, most certainly would. But there is a clause in the Fourth Amendment too, without reasonable cause. And so if, let's just say that I'm a deputy and I hear about a O.J. Simpson white Bronco, right?
Okay.
And it's missing, has three individuals, three college girls in there, it's missing over the weekend. If I see that overturned in a field, on private land, in a ravine, I don't need a search warrant at that point because I have probable cause.
Sure.
And as it should be. So the same thing would be kind of on the ice house effect too. Are you fishing in there? Well, I have problems with the Game and Fish coming in and being able to check my freezer and stuff without a search warrant. They should fall under the same guidelines. Mm-hmm. They should not be exempt from the Fourth Amendment.
So like game and fish can come into your house or not?
I would have to check all the legalities on that, but over the years that has been very, very much the case. They say they're going to check your freezer, they just come in, wow. No search warrant.
So how does this proposed bill affect what happens and what doesn't happen?
In 30 seconds or less, tell us that.
This bill would be recognizing, just like in North Dakota with vehicles, it would be recognizing that all outbuildings, every outbuilding on private land would have Fourth Amendment rights for anybody owning those buildings.
So they'd need a search warrant?
They would need a search warrant, yes.
Got it.
Whether it was on your home quarter or a section away or whatever, as long as it was in your name, it would apply, is what you're saying.
Okay. Absolutely. And like you said, it's stretched out so far now. Where you store your grain could be miles from your home.
Wow. Yeah, that's just it. We have so much more to talk about, but we're going to take a quick break and be back with Luke Simons after this and other messages on Ladies of Another View on Beck.
Stuff everywhere. It's so embarrassing. Ruins the neighborhood. Come on, humans, let's get this fixed.
Don't let your roof go to the dogs. Call America's Best Contractors for your free estimate.
Need a new woof?
After checking with the rest, go with the best. America's Best Contractors. 258-2412. Online at americasbestcontractorsincorporated.com.
In southwestern and south central North Dakota, on any given day at any given moment, a Dakota Community Bank and Trust customer is logging in or signing on to do their online or mobile banking. We believe that community banking can blend both a past with down-home customer service in-house and a future with modern banking conveniences and technology for our customers anywhere, like here or here, all while honoring our long-standing tradition of community-first-oriented banking here at Dakota Community Bank and Trust.
My wife was diagnosed with early stage Alzheimer's. We talked about it and we kind of decided we'd be a little bit proactive and try to start making provisions. So we started looking here and Eventide worked out to be pretty much the perfect answer. I guess I didn't expect it to be so nice. The staff here are terrific. We enjoy it.
Beck News brings you real people and real news. Every weekday on KNDB, KNDM, and KRDK. Start your evening with the Dr. Duke Show at 4. Take a fresh look at current events with Ladies of Another View at 4:30. Go down the road with Joel at 5:30. Watch No Apologies with Becker at 9. Cap off your night with No Filter with Debbie at 10. Beck News. Real people, real news.
The professionals at Superior Glass provide residential and commercial glass installation and repair services in central and western North Dakota. Superior Glass is your source for stained glass projects, mirrors, windows, touchless, and automated entry solutions. Stop by and see us at 3323 East Broadway in Bismarck or call us at 701-258-5600. Superior Glass, where you get superior service for less. Bye for now.
Welcome back to Ladies of Another View on Beck. With us today is Luke Simons, a representative out of the Dickinson area. Before the break, we were talking about some search and seizure type stuff with the search warrant, I should say. And that was House Bill number 1340. And I want to encourage all our viewers, if you have questions regarding any bills that we mention or any bills that are talked about on our show, Call your legislators. Give them a call, email them, write to them. It's the only way things get changed. And so we're so excited that in the next few weeks, we're going to have quite a few legislators up here. But we are today, we're blessed with Luke Simons. He's going to talk a little bit about a couple other bills that you have on the horizon. Why don't you explain those to us?
Sure. And if anybody would like to contact me on any of these bills, just give me a call, 701-260-3914. Also on my Facebook page, I post every single day what bills were on the House floor, how I voted on them, if they passed or failed. Sometimes I'll explain why I voted no or why I voted yes. So there's that too. I have a House bill, 1272. It's a bill that was in Montana. And of course, states' rights are a huge thing. And you don't hear this much anymore, but the last page of your Declaration of Independence, by the way, if you show up to the House floor and ask me for a U.S. Constitution, I will get you one of those too. You should have one in your home. It's wrote on an eighth grade education level, and anybody can understand it.
So any of today's graduates should understand it if it's written on an eighth grade level?
I hope so.
Did I just say that?
Yeah.
We'll talk about education another time.
Yeah. Right. Yes, I'm glad you brought that up. But. Yeah. So it's a state's rights bill. I entered this bill in 2016, and it got smacked down pretty good. But I brought it back again because of our new president. And by the way, I pray for my new president. I do, that the Lord will give him wisdom and maybe a closer walk with the Lord as well.
And maybe a spine too?
Yeah, well, it depends on which way he's going to use that spine.
Right, right. Yeah.
But in saying that though, it's a states' rights bill. So we have Colorado, who openly defied federal regulations against marijuana. Now a bunch of states jumped in. Federal government didn't buck them at all. We have cities all over the place that have sanctuary cities against illegal aliens. And so why don't we do the same thing when it comes to the Second Amendment? Let the states decide. Now, some people don't understand or never had it taught to them where the states come to be on this. The state controls something called commerce. In other words, if I drive something to Montana, when I cross that medicine line, at that point, the federal government does have some say there. But inside the state, it is very sovereign. And I was saying that about the Constitution. The last paragraph of the Declaration of Independence said, "We sovereign 13 states declare our independence from the state of Great Britain." State at that time meant country. So we are 50 sovereign countries that come together under five reasons. And you have to forgive me because I always talk about the Constitution, it seems.
And we're glad you do, because we all need a refresher course. We really do.
For sure. Yeah.
So this bill would say, whatever the state legislature okays in North Dakota for guns is okay in North Dakota. Now, I still have a problem with that because I don't see anywhere in my Constitution where it says if the guns are okayed by the state legislature, it said shall not be infringed. But this is a pushback because our new president said that he would outlaw AR-15s. And AR-15s are a beautiful, beautiful
What
gun.
Am I going to shoot my coyotes with if I don't have an AR-15?
That's right.
I'm serious.
It is a awesome coyote machine.
It is. It really is.
So this bill would make it and protect anybody with any kind of gun accessories, any kind of firearm that is made and okayed by the state legislature would be okay. And the federal guidelines would be a nice suggestion, but we're not listening to that here. And so I hope this year that we have a lot of traction on that bill. So that's my main gun bill. I do have another gun bill. It's year 1339, which is just clearing up. I mean, if you have a throwing star, you shouldn't be faced with dangerous weapon if it comes down to it, just in case you have a throwing star on you.
I don't, but I know that there's been some kids that have gotten them like for Christmas, and they take it to school to show all their friends, and they get in big trouble.
It's considered a dangerous weapon. You might as well have a pistol on you, and it's just ridiculous. So there's a lot of things like a samurai sword, for example, a bunch of things that we need to clean up in our century code. So that's just a little one that I'm working on. I also have an interesting one, too. Some ex-Amish people came and talked to me. They came to our church. They're no longer Amish, but they had no Social Security numbers growing up. And they were fishing, and the game warden came along and said, you need a fishing license. I didn't know that. So he went to go get his fishing license, and they said, well, you need a Social Security card. He looked at the person, and I kid you not, he said, how do the fish know if I have a Social Security card? So I kind of thought that was kind of interesting.
Perfect.
And my great-grandpa's first Social Security card said, right stamped all the way across it, said, not for identification use.
Exactly.
And of course, now, I mean, good luck. Good luck. You need a Social Security card for everything, which is not right. And there's a group of people in North Dakota, a large group, I was surprised, that contacted me and said, we are forced to drive illegally because we don't have Social Security cards. They were legally born in the USA without Social Security. They opted out from the very beginning.
I didn't know you could.
Not anymore, you can't, I don't think. When my last baby, that's 23 years ago, I had to have a Social Security number at birth if I wanted to open any kind of savings account. Or, you know, from the get-go, you had to fill out Social Security form in the hospital almost, I think it was. Yeah.
There are still people that are born without them and are not using them. Minnesota has an opt-out, so you don't need a Social Security card to drive. Banking, a lot of them just keep cash. It's a unique situation.
It is. I've worked in some of those communities in the past down in South Dakota, the Hutterites and the Mennonites, and they don't. And so none of them have a Social Security card, but they don't have money on them either. It's more like a community fund where, you know, all the meat money goes, or the milk money, or the chicken money, whatever it goes. And so they technically don't have an income, but they all live within the community. They eat together. You know, they all have houses, but it's very communal, shall we say. So we got a couple minutes left, but ladies, do you have some questions?
Would they have to have, I'm just questioning because there's been that big push as far as voter ID that, well, they've got dead people's Social Security numbers and they've got, you know, things like that. And I don't know how that all ties in and what's really a legal must-have and what isn't when it comes to voting. But even for proof of ID, even though it says not to be used for that, how many times do we run into that? And what are the ramifications, say, in voting or in proving you are who you say you are if you're trying to infiltrate into the state for nefarious reasons? You know what I mean?
In 1 minute or less, can you answer that?
That might be hard to do. And under that same piece of century code, it also talks about illegal immigrants, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, because they don't have Social Security cards. They have green cards. So they still can get a driver's license with a green card.
Right.
So I think it's maybe a different issue,
sure.
Really. It's just
sure.
An exemption that they file, and they are legally able to drive and drive an automobile without a driver's license.
And so as far as the Amish here in North Dakota, how do they get a driver's license? We have about 15 seconds. Do they have a valid driver's license?
Right now in the state of North Dakota, they would have to get a Social Security card.
They do.
Which they're exempt of because they take care of their old.
Oh, okay.
So they're paying a tax that they'll never use.
I see.
It's interesting. It's not tax evasion.
Do you think you want to stick around and visit with us for one more segment? We would love to have you and ask you a few questions, unless you have something to do at the Capitol.
Well, just so they don't sell this for like sleep medicine or something.
Okay, all right. We'll be right back after these messages on Ladies of Another View on Beck.
Howdy, folks. It's the Cantaline Cafe. I reckon it's time you're due for a hearty meal. So saddle up for the day with one of our Hey Boss and Breakfast homemade soups. Fill your grill, add a salad bar, sink your teeth into our famous Cantaline Burger and barbecue ribs. Top it off with spur rattling pie or a calm roll that's sure to put a smile on even the toughest outlaws. Yeah. Shake the dirt off the boots each night and warm up with the game. Tell them about it, Stacy.
I can't wait to see you at the county line.
Since opening in Hebron in 1940, Dakota Community Bank and Trust has been your hometown bank. Our mission has been to provide modern banking convenience with old-fashioned hometown service. We've grown with the communities we serve. Through year-round events, countless sponsorships, and nearly 7,000 hours of volunteering each year. Learn more about our 80-year history at dakotacommunitybank.com.
Jeez, what a mess. Look at that. There's roof stuff everywhere. It's so embarrassing. Ruins the neighborhood. Come on, humans. Let's get this fixed.
Don't let your roof go to the dogs. Call America's Best Contractors for your free estimate.
Need a new woof?
After checking with the rest, go with the best. America's Best Contractors. 258-2412. Online at americasbestcontractorsincorporated.com.
For the greatest selection and full menu offering, it's the Four Seasons Restaurant and Ice Cream Parlor in Garrison. Succulent sandwiches, big breakfast served all day, and delicious desserts. Easy access in and out for campers and RVs. The Four Seasons Restaurant at the top of Main Street, Garrison.
Things in life are hard. That's why banking shouldn't be. Cornerstone Bank.
Welcome back to Ladies of Another View on Beck. Luke Simons has decided to stick around with us, and we're so grateful for that. We're learning so much. We talked a little bit on the break about licenses, and we came up with another issue. Tell us about that. Well, first of all, for those of you that don't know, Luke is also a barber. So a barber, a rancher, and a legislator. I mean, the full package here. But we bring you only the best guests. Anyway, so tell us a little bit about that story about the license.
Well, I have a man that works in my barber shop with me, and he was
working... A Dickinson man?
No, sorry. He's from Ghana.
Ghana,
yeah.
Okay.
And he's just an absolute awesome young man. Well, he's 29 now, I guess. But, and single, ladies, if you're looking, he's very single.
Oh, the single ladies. The single ladies.
So has he been here a long time?
He's been here 4 years, okay. And he was working... Four jobs. He was working 100 and, well, anywhere from 90 to 110 hours a week. Wow. I tease him about that because he doesn't work quite that much anymore. And he one day went to go get a haircut, and he realized that in Western North Dakota, there wasn't too many people that knew how to cut people's hair from Ghana. And he paid what he thought was an absurd, a lot of money for it, and he thought, well, I'm a barber. That's what he did in his home country. His brothers were barbers, and one day they were busy, and they just threw him in the chair, and he said he was horrible, and he got better. That's what he did. He started cutting hair, and he was a pretty good barber. then things changed. He had the opportunity. His dad sold a lot of land so that he could have the opportunity, still the land of opportunity. I think it's interesting how Americans don't see it that way anymore, but other people certainly do. And he came to the land of the free, home of the brave, and he was getting his haircut, and he thought, I'm going to. He figured out how much his haircut cost and how many he could do a day. I'm going to go cut hair again. So he went to this really nice place in Dickinson.
And does this place have a name?
It does. Men's Den. Yep.
Men's Den.
Yep.
Dickinson.
And but for good haircuts, you want to go to the Gentleman's Barber.
Oh, the Gentleman's Barber, yeah. Of course. Yes.
So, and he asked them. He said, "I'm a barber. I'd like to cut hair." And they were extremely happy to have him. He's a good, sharp man. And so he pretty much got all of his paperwork done and everything. They said, "Where's your barber's license?" And he gave him his driver's license. Speaking of driver's license, that's what we got on this subject.
Yeah.
And he said, they said, "Oh no, you had to have a barber's license." And he looked at him and he goes, "Barber's license?" He goes, "I thought this was the land of the free." He goes, "Why would I need a barber's license?" He said, "I know how to cut hair. If they don't like it, they don't need to come back." And, you know, out of the eyes and mouth of the innocent sometimes, we have become so adapted to the concepts of, I need a license, I need to do this, I need to do that. No, actually, in a free country, you wouldn't need a license. I was just recently in another country, a couple of years ago now, and that's exactly how it is. They kill a cow in the back and they serve it in the front, and I'll guarantee you there's no license there. And it's interesting. Another thing too I've noticed with a governor holding licensing from people, you submit to what I'm saying or I'll pull your license, whether that be a liquor license, whether that be any kind of license. That is a real hostile environment, in my opinion.
Blackmail.
It's blackmail.
Absolutely.
It's 100% blackmail.
You must comply.
Yes.
Yeah. You must comply.
If the governor can't come and shut my barbershop down, which I won't shut down. And by the way, in Dickinson, we don't use masks when we cut hair. We just don't. If you don't like it, you can go somewhere else. But then at that point, what they do is they put pressure on my licensing to shut me down, which is bizarre. It's interesting.
Yeah. It's like, where's my country? Where's my state?
You know?
I mean, that's where I go to. Through all this mess that we've just gotten done with on a national level, it's like, where's my country that I grew up in even? And it was already restrictive, you know, even then, but not like today. It's more and more. And, you know, every legislative session, I kind of grit my teeth. It's like, how many more restrictions and things are going to get put on us as citizens this time around? Mm. You know, so it's...
It does seem that there's a little bit more of, let's give you back some of what you're supposed to have in this year's session. Do you agree? Or do you think that it's business as usual?
It sounds like it's business as usual, it sounds to me. Mark Twain once said, "No man's life, liberty, or property is safe while Congress is in session." And I tend to agree with that statement. My job as a state legislator is not to represent the state. It is to represent the people's God-given rights. That is in black and white. That is literally my job description. And we have full circled to now I represent the state instead of the people's rights. My job is to protect that we do not have oversight on any piece of legislation that would affect somebody's life, someone's liberty, or someone's... Originally, in the Declaration of Independence, it said property, but they rewrote that to say happiness. And the reason they rewrote that was, they all came from pretty much Europe. And unless you were of noble blood, the concept of ownership was a new concept. We are talking about our ancestors never seen the day where they thought they could own something. I mean, that's sobering. to think.
Sure.
If you were on your land, it was because the Duke or Duchess allowed it to be so, who taxed you an extraordinary amount of taxes, who they then paid the king or queen an extraordinary amount of taxes. So when people got on these things called spaceships back in the day, which were, I mean, if you think about it, ships, they didn't see their families, which is really extraordinary. I get a lot of people from Africa. These people are married, happily married, 4 or 5 children. They love their children very much, and they haven't seen their family for 5 to 6 years because they came to the land of the free, home of the brave, to make something for their family. Our ancestors did the exact same thing. And it's just interesting to me to think about these concepts of ownership. What is ownership? This is my pen. You take my pen, I should be able to sue you, or it's just against the law, I can get a constable. But if you can come and steal my pen, or pencil in this case, and there's no repercussions, therefore my life, my liberty, it's all gone. So just little things that we stop teaching in schools. We don't teach history anymore in schools.
Well, and even in my own family, I mean, my dad's grandmother was, we still don't know for sure, but we think we know how old she was. We think we know when she was born. She was born on a ship on the way from Norway. I mean, there weren't birth certificates. There weren't, my grandmother on my mom's side, there was never a definite what her age was. They thought she was born in 1898, but, you know, could have been, you know. But there was that kind of thing. But you had that freedom in this country. You had a family, you had a baby. And yeah, you put it in the Bible or you didn't. I mean, it was a whole different, and yet it was freedom. And that's what everybody fought so hard to get. You know, the Homestead Act and how many Norwegians came for 160 acres. I mean, huge numbers, and they left their families behind, and just to reunite.
So we have about 30 seconds left. Do you have any advice on anyone who wants to know more about maybe even becoming a legislator to fight for the good cause for just the everyday person like us?
Oh, absolutely. I would first say get involved in your first state of government, which is your school boards. That's what you should do.
15 seconds.
And give me a call any given time, and I will hook you up with some great, great people that will help you run for office. And the truth is, you've got to get to know your current sitting legislators. A lot of them are really good people. They just are surrounded by people that I get 100 to 1 conservatives. One conservative will call me, and the rest are all the opposite of that, telling me to vote on it.
Sure. Okay. All right. Well, Luke, obviously, I think we're going to have you back. We got to take a break right now, but thank you for coming, and we'll be right back after these messages on Ladies of Another View on Back.
Howdy, folks. It's a Cantaline Cafe. I reckon it's time you're due for a hearty meal. So saddle up for the day with one of our Hey Boss and Breakfast homemade soups. Fill your grill at our salad bar. Sink your teeth into our famous Cantaline Burger and barbecue ribs. Top it off with spur rattling pie or a conch roll that's sure to put a smile on even the toughest outlaws. Yeah. Shake the dirt off the boots each night and warm up with the game. Tell them about it, Stacy.
I can't wait to see you at the county line.
Hi, I'm Dennis Haugen, along with my sons Andy and Mike, and we're showing our support for wind energy in North Dakota.
Wind energy has provided farmers like us with a steady stream of income that's not tied to the weather, like crops and cattle are.
Another bonus is that wind farm owners are required to maintain the roads leading up to the turbines. Because of that, oftentimes these roads are the best in the county.
Wind energy is good for landowners, it's good for the land, it's good for our economy, and it's good for North Dakota.
Capital City Restaurant Supply is your one-stop shop for quality restaurant products for the large to small kitchens. Commercial grade restaurant and bar supplies, limb game processing equipment, refrigeration, dinnerware, and smallware. We sell everything including the kitchen sink for trusted manufacturers for the chef and all of us. Open to the public since 1971, we are veteran owned and North Dakota proud. Let us take care of your restaurant and home kitchen needs today by visiting us at 1414 Interstate Loop in Bismarck or on the web at CapitalCityRestaurantSupply.com.
My wife was diagnosed with early stage Alzheimer's, we talked about it and we kind of decided we'd be a little bit proactive and try to start making provisions. So we started looking here, and Eventide worked out to be pretty much the perfect answer. I guess I didn't expect it to be so nice. The staff here are terrific. We enjoy it.
The professionals at Superior Glass provide residential and commercial glass installation and repair services in central and western North Dakota. Superior Glass is your source for stained glass projects, mirrors, windows, touchless, and automated entry solutions. Stop by and see us at 3323 East Broadway in Bismarck, or call us at 701-258-5600. Superior Glass, where you get superior service for less. Bye for now.
Now is the best time to plan for your 2021 farm equipment needs. North Dakota-based Summers Manufacturing is currently offering early order savings. Take advantage of big savings on North America's broadest tillage line, including the Super Colder Samurai and the innovative BRT Renegade, as well as the best-built, best-backed land rollers in the industry. Talk to your Summers dealer today or go to summersmfg.com to learn more about early order savings available on all Summers equipment.
Welcome back to Ladies of Another View on Beck. I'm kind of excited about this part. When I saw President Trump give his farewell speech this morning, or his second farewell speech, I should say, I saw a lot of hope. I saw a lot of promise. I saw a lot of that we can't give up. And it was so interesting. He uses the song YMCA, and it was written by Victor Willis. And there's a lot of, at first people said, you can't use those songs. You know, there was a lot of artists that said, nope, you can't use my song without paying me. You can't use it, can't use it. But Victor Willis had a different idea about that. He said, well, he can use it. He's the president. He said, Victor Willis, the songwriter responsible for the smash hit YMCA, stated that he had no problem with Trump using the song, but he did have one suggestion. Willis released a statement in which he talked about the song's meaning and its use at Trump rallies. YMCA is everybody's anthem and a go-to song for fun. As for the president's use, I have not granted permission for use at his rallies because permission is not required. The musician continued, if I were a Trump hater, maybe I'd sue him for simply out of spite. I am not, and I'm not going to have my lawyer sue the president. Then Willis made this demand known, but he should at least do the YMCA dance while he's at it. So with that, I want to show you. This is what he came up with, and you know, maybe he's not the best dancer, but check this out. I think it's so cute.
Say this.
Yeah, it was. It's so fun. I mean, when
it
you
is, it
when
is.
you take a look at that, it's been like I said, it gave me hope. It gave me joy. And he's not the best dancer, but it's just fun. You know, everyone thinks he's so serious all the time, and he's not.
Yeah.
But it was just kind of a nice way for him to go out. It gave us hope, and it's like, he said, this isn't over. This is just the beginning.
Yeah.
So, you know, we don't know if he's going to start another party. We don't know what's going to happen. But right. I truly think a lot of his stuff is going to live on.
Yeah, I do too. I do too. And just today watching, you know, had the family on the runway and watching him hug that little grandson of his, you know, and just So many things that we don't, and I'm not saying Trump is unique in this. A lot of times we don't get to see a lot of the family interaction, and it was really nice to be able to see some of that. And it, just to know that family is so important, you know, and he said his family, they could have had a lot easier life, but they all worked during his term, and they did. And I think that's worth mentioning, you know, they didn't say, oh yeah, dad's there and we're going to do our thing. And, it was really very cool to see upstanding, nice kids do their part in helping this country as well. So
absolutely. Yeah. And you know, it was positive in a way that even if there's no new party and there's no new anything, he woke the people up in a way that got them more involved again. They started watching what's going on. They started taking responsibility for what's happening around them. And I think that was a positive thing as well.
Yeah.
And they started showing up at rallies and dancing.
Big time.
We haven't seen that before, you know, that kind of enthusiasm in the crowds. And Ivanka gave a beautiful message, too, that it was she was privileged and honored to have served the United States and been kind of an advisor to the president. So I really do appreciate that positive, outgoing message.
And to be your best.
And be your best, absolutely.
Yeah. Just watching, like you said, the crowds. You know, I saw more crowds on the runway today at his farewell than I think we're going to be seen at the inauguration today.
Inauguration.
I don't mean that in a bad way, but I mean,
I'll say it in a bad way.
Well, it makes you question everything. If he really won in that a margin, then why isn't the support there, and why is he guarded by razor wire? I don't get it.
And why are the locks on the gates on the opposite side? If you guys are paying attention to something or some of the things going on in D.C., they have a fence all the way around it, but the locks are on the outside. So are they locking people in? The razor wire, it's on the out.
I've never seen an inauguration like that. That's sad. That is sad.
And
if
you look back to President Trump's inauguration, that's when the left got so upset. They burnt the cities. You know, the cities were burning down.
They wore the famous hats, the famous costumes that I'm not even going to talk about.
I don't know why they amped up all the security, because it was Antifa that started the riots in D.C. It was a Trump rally where a few people got out of hand, and that's what they're concentrating on. That's not how the conservative vote.
That's their MO.
It would be nice. It would be nice to see
National Guard troops. That was silly.
And that number's not even for sure. You know, every report I see, one says 15, next one says 25, one says 60.
So anyway, we appreciate all of you guys joining us today, and we appreciate Mr. Simons joining in on us. And if you ever have any questions, just forward them to us. And enjoy life, and we're going to be back tomorrow. That's YMCA.
I don't know
the letters.
We're at.
I'll just do this.
Yeah, there we go. What did that?
The Trump dance.
There you go.
Anyway, we'll be back tomorrow on Ladies of Another View on Beck.